How is everyone? Well, we're going to get better. However we are, we're going to get better right now because we're doing this positivity training. If we say my future is going to be great, it will be. My destiny is going to be great, it will be. Because we're the ones who are actually in charge of it. Our spirit is in charge of it. So our experiencing has no choice but to conform to this. The trouble we get into is turning our destiny over to the ego and its promises that says, I'll make it even better and even and sooner. And the ego's great at promises. It never delivers. So we need to say, hey, my future is going to be tremendous. There's no question about it. It's unquestionable. Unquestionably, my future is going to be tremendous. Nothing can stand in the way because this is what I really want. This is what I really want. Now, the Holy Spirit is what we are. So having the Holy Spirit can take charge of our destiny is really us taking charge of our destiny. We've been trying to give our destiny away. We've been trying to give our reality away. We've been trying to give our identity. We've been trying to change what we are. And we're so used to this that we need some reassurance that comes from the Holy Spirit. So, if you're like me, you're surrounded by negativity. People seem to be professional negatives, professional at it, very good at it. I don't know what they expect to get out of it, really. Doesn't matter. I don't know what the game the ego goddess is playing, but I don't like the outcome, and so I don't have to know what the game is exactly. I just know I don't want to play the game, that's all. I don't have to know what it's about exactly. I just don't like it, don't want to play it. So that's it. This is a way to very quickly get free, because the ego says, well, you don't know what the game is. How do you know? So I don't need to know. I want to play some other game. That's all there is to it. And right there we get better. So today was a perfect example of the discipline of the spiritual path, in that huge, huge, heavy insights arose, and I was able to full stop in the wow during most of the day and not get pulled into all the traps that arise when great insight arises. Frustration, come on, I need to get it right now, hurry up, you know, how come I, you know, all this stuff. You say, no, I'm just going to be patient with this. So perfect example that this is an everyday occurrence. Today the insights were just extremely relevant and impactful, and I can't even remember what they were. That's not the point. I know that the point is to manage the success of the insight and the wow of the insight going forward. And if we do this properly, then greater insights will arise the next day and the next day. This has been true. So don't worry, like, say, oh my gosh, I almost had it. I really saw so important. Just say, wow, okay, that's great. I had the insight. Okay, now let me just see if I can keep myself stable in the wow, not struggle, not get angry, not get frustrated, not get hyper, not just stay calm and just keep, stay and take it in stride. And this is the answer. So don't get suckered into struggling with any insight. See, we are the truth. So the insights come to us. They have no choice but to come to us. We just have to allow them and say, okay, you can come now. And you can come here now. I'm ready for you. And so insight arrives and we say, okay, great. And we work on the wow of that shock. And once we get over that, then okay, I'm ready for the next one. And like that. I've seen 2 days in a row now, this major psych out, how we psych ourselves out. I said, okay, great. We're seeing that more and more, and I'm just getting used to being able to see that. So I don't try to see it again. See, full stop on the wow, you're not trying to do anything. You're not entertaining any storylines, any strategies, any hope for failure or success. Neither nor is a positive neutrality, you might say. It's not really neutral. We say it's neutral, but it's really a practice of non-objectifying. It's neither this nor that. There's no objectivity in reality at all. Nothing is objectified, actually. And this is part of the insight I had. Nothing is objectified. I was reading from the book The Spaciousness from Longchenpa quite a bit, and just little snippets of it, just wow, 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 wow. It's hitting home. It's hitting home. All this is hitting home. And the insights are arising, and this causes a temporary disturbance. Like, and there's a tendency to go running back to the ego, but just say, no, I'm not going to do that, and I'm not going to try to push myself forward too fast. I'm just going to take it in stride. Say, okay, this is where I'm at now. We slow down to go faster. This is the secret. And it's a tough discipline, because you think, oh, I worked so hard for so long, and suddenly this insight came, and if I just pursue this, I feel I'm going to finally succeed. This is the sucker play. We receive the insight we're ready for, but this shocks us. We could say, oh my gosh, this is a game changer. This is really a huge game changer. And so we have to settle into that game-changing acceptance first. Once we do, then the next insight, the even greater clarity will arise for us. But if we know if we pursue that insight and struggle with it, we're going to actually lose ground. We're going to come undone. You've seen some adepts in the history of adepts, and they always seem so patient, don't they? Calm, patient. You feel like, wow, they must have spent a lot of time and a great deal of patience. There's a saying, don't push the river. Don't try to push the river. The river of insight, just let it come to you. Has no choice but to come to you, because we are the truth. We are the light of the world. Everything is the truth, is the light of the world. There's no objectification at all. So we practice positivity. Say, thank you God, the Holy Spirit, for the tremendous future that you're giving to me. Try doing that, and try believing in it. This is again a super, super high effective technique, if for those who actually employ it. And I'm doing it right now. I'm able to employ this. I say, thank you, Holy Spirit, for the marvelous future that you're giving me. And of course, we're speaking just here in flipping the script mode. It's assertion mode, it's practice mode. And so we understand we're not trying to be academically correct or spiritually correct by saying future. Say, oh, well, you know, I don't have any time. it's a shorthand. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for this great future that you're going to give me. In other words, my experiencing is going to get better and better and better and better in the moment, in the now. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for the just a splendid experiencing that you have already given to me, that I'm moving into. Now, here's a great example to listen to. Today it's been 3 weeks since I've done any running, well, formally running, and I've been a few dashing around a little bit here and there, but not actually getting out and running. And I said, I have to start now. I know, I just have to get started today. Got to. Otherwise, I'm going to sit out the whole Christmas season, and this is a disaster. So I said, okay, I'll do it. And I was close to getting home, and I realized, okay, when I get home, I have to do it. And then suddenly this feeling arose in me, I can't do it. I just cannot do it. And it was just such a strong feeling. I said, wow, that's terrible. And so I got home and I couldn't do it. And I had to sleep. I had to take a rest. I was so tired and weak and tired. Then I got up finally. And then I said, well, let me at least stretch. So I went through a stretching routine and limbering up. And I still couldn't do it. And finally, I decided, you know what? I'm going to do half the route. I'm going to start off with in the beginner's route again, and just do, half of what I was expecting to do. Soon as I said that, my mood picked up. I said, maybe I can do that. I was thinking I have to start again after 3 weeks with a full circuit, and no. So I was able to do it. I did it. It wasn't too bad at all. I said, well, I can do that. So when we take a break, we can't necessarily jump right back in into the deep end. And so this is what the problem was. So as we go forward, when we're don't if we feel like I can't do it, I can't do it. Well, do half of it then. Do half of it. Something like that. Do half of it. Maybe scale it back a little bit. And so I say, well, I'll see how it goes. I'll see. Maybe I'll run the half track for however long it feels that I feel strong enough. Then I'll maybe tackle the other one, and ease back into it like that. So when we go through the wow of insight, when we get back the next day, don't think, okay, I got to start where it left off, and I got to jump. Just say, let me ease into it. Let me just do a little bit of practice here. Let me do a little practice and see if I can practice. And then you say, oh, I can do it. It's not so bad. And then maybe later in the day, you practice some more, and then you get even deeper. I got very deep today into the resistance, the egoic resistance, and I said, okay, all right. But tomorrow, it's not so easy to get that deep, so I have to maybe I'll just start out easy. Start out easy in the morning and start doing read from spaciousness, read from something that gets me going, and just sort of work into it, and don't try to force things, and don't expect, well, I'm going to be able to do this or that. Just say, let me see how I feel. Just like this running, I wanted to see how can I handle the half track. How did I handle it? Well, I handled it actually very well, but still, my legs felt heavy, and I said, "Wow, I'm not. I've lost a little bit of conditioning somehow, even though I have been trying to stay in shape." And but that happens. So don't think I gotta jump in right, to the depths right away. It's probably not going to happen that way. Let it come to you. Let it come to you. It will come back again more quickly than we realize. This abidance, this abidance, this abidance. I'm looking. Keep looking at it. Keep looking at it. Keep looking at it. Keep looking at it. Keep stretching. Keep the flexibility. Keep the flexibility. Well, I did jump rope today. Just keep doing. Maybe not all out, but that's okay. Maybe halfway or three quarters of the way. Same with dieting. I actually hit a lower weight than before, ever before. Now I said, wow, that's really something. But then I went and ate a good dinner, because I said, I'm not going to starve myself. That's not good. If I starve myself, I could get even lower. But let's not try to force the issue. Let's not try to force it. We can do it without trying to force the issue. This is the discipline. When we try to force the issue, this is when we run into troubles. Because the resistance is so tricky, and we psych ourselves out, and we're so upset at ourselves for being so stupid, and we've got the continuity fear, and there's so much involved actually that we have to be compassionate with ourselves and not try to force the issue. At the same hand, we don't quit. We stay close to it. We stay close. Say, okay, when opportunity comes, I'm going to be ready. I'm going to be fit. So I keep working out. I worked out this morning, upper body, and this evening running, and also upper body. Just a little bit, just enough to feel it. Feeling like, yeah, I'm really going in the right direction. So keep going in the right direction. Keep going in the right direction. The tortoise wins the race, Aesop's fable. The hare does not win the race. The hare tries to force the issue, And then knocks the hare out. I can't handle it anymore, and goes to sleep. The tortoise just keeps plodding along. So we're plodders. We plod along, plod along, plod along. We're not these big superstars on the path. Let the superstardom come when we finish. On the path, let's just be, you know, plod along here. Do the best we can, but don't force, don't try to force the issue. Be aware that the wow, the backlash is very significant. Standing up to these icons, these idols that we have tried to put in charge of our life, standing up to these idols is quite intimidating and shocking. And of course, the idols have these endless lies that seem so seductive. So we know the game doesn't end well for us. So just because we don't know how it's played, we know it doesn't end well. So we don't want it. We don't need it. We don't want it. So the attitude is not some spiritual superstar on the path. It's this not being crushed. It's staying engaged with it. Staying calmly, patiently engaged. Very difficult, but very doable. Because we think these idols are going to be furious with us that we stand up to them, because we've told them to be so, we've told them to intimidate us. We've told them that we're subject to them, subject to their wrath, even though we're not. So you might feel very small and little, and as you stand up to these idols, you might feel like almost, wow, I'm almost being crushed, but you just say, oh, I'm just going to hang in there. See what happens. Just hang in there and see what happens. Starting to have good dreams again. Very, very powerful dreams again. Of recognition, dreams of recognition. That when we see that we've just psyched ourselves out, we see how we psyched ourselves out, we just say, wow, that is so stupid. But what we do here, we stop that. We say, no, just wow. Just wow. No other reaction. That's it. All other characterizations are put to rest. We just say, okay, wow. Not non-judgmental, sort of a non-judgmental reaction. Just wow. Sort of encompasses the whole gamut of how we feel. Just wow. Don't feel positive, don't feel negative. We're feeling something. It's not just a no feeling state. There's an intensity. But it's sort of an abstract. It encompasses the whole gamut of reaction. And we're not emphasizing anything in particular. We're just letting the entire ball of wax melt, evaporate. We're letting all the reactions to it just evaporate without picking or choosing what evaporates or whatever. Just let the whole thing evaporate. And whatever is good and whatever is true will remain. So we don't have to pick and choose. This is what the great teachers tell us. Jesus said, let go, give everything to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will filter it all and return to you only what is good and true and what you really want. So we hold the whole reaction, the whole spectrum of reaction up just as, and just say, wow. And then just hold it up and let it, the evaporation, do its work, the dissipation, let it dwindle. And whatever I get, as good and true, will remain, will remain. Call it spiritual alchemy if you want, but there's no idea of that in my mind. It's just simply just stay in the wow, stay in the wow. We're not picking and choosing what evaporates and what stays at all. So I think this is a better way to look at it, a clearer way. We're not picking and choosing, and so this is very important. When we get to these heavy insights, and you will get to them, it's inevitable. I sure did today, and I do every day, but today was even stronger. Just lift the whole reaction up as one basket of reaction. Let's say there's a basket full of reaction. Just lift the whole basket up. And just say, okay, I'm just going to hold it up to the light. And whatever stays, stays. Whatever goes, goes. I'm not going to pay attention to what's staying and what's going. I'll find out later on in hindsight what has stayed. I don't care what's gone. Whatever's gone, I didn't really want it in the first place. So I'll find out in hindsight what has stayed. So don't be overly curious. Curiosity killed the cat. That's funny. I was at this store. I don't know if I said this or not before. It said there's this wooden box with a cover, and it says free. Take one. And I'm saying, I'm looking at what's free? Take what is there to take? And I didn't see that. That's weird. And so the box had a little tiny knob on the lid. So sort of the lid had a knob, and so I said, maybe it slides, and it slides open. Said, oh, let me see what's inside there. And I slid it open, and this spider jumped out and hit my hand. it was a plastic spider on a little plastic what do you say, stand or something, flexible stand. And it, when you open it up, it, like a jack in the box, it pops out, and it's a big black spider. I went, whoa. And the guy at the counter is laughing. He says, got another one. He says, it's curiosity. We can't resist curiosity. And I said, wow, you're right. This is one of the most powerful attributes we have, is we're curious. And I said, I hope I'm not the only one. He says, oh, you don't know how many have done that. It's a basic trait. I said, you're right, curiosity. But it was a mistake. I should have thought it through better, but I sort of wanted to see what was going to happen. And so I played it out, and then he told me curiosity. And so now I'm realizing curiosity is what really sinks our ship on the path. We have to have faith, not curiosity. So we're not going on curiosity here. I know the teachers, the great teachers, have succeeded. What they say is true. There's no doubt what they say is true. So. It's faith. I'm sure of it. But we cannot get waylaid by curiosity and say, well, I'm curious, what is evaporating, what is not evaporating? Then we bring the basket down and we start trying to evaluate everything. And then we start getting all fragmented, feeling meaningless, getting frustrated. All these different reactions start bubbling up in us. And we say, oh, this is hideous. I can't stand this. This is too much. The path is terrible. We must avoid curiosity in this way. And this is why we sit here silently saying, I'm not going to do anything. I'm not going to pull that basket down. I'm just going to leave it up there. Tremendous discipline is required. And yet we have that capacity. We all do. But we're constantly being bombarded with advice, wrong advice from the ego. The world is so egoic. It's just overflowing with egoic advice. I try to insulate myself from the world. It's very important to. Just anytime I get any feedback from the world, it's always the wrong advice. Unless it's guided by the Holy Spirit. But if you... And of course, everything is. So if you take it in the right way, it can be helpful. But you have to be very intuitive about it. But still, the Holy Spirit will say, hey, don't watch television. So if it says that, don't be curious. Say, I wonder why the Holy Spirit says not watch television. Let me find out. That's curiosity. That's curiosity. That killed the cat. The cat is very agile and nimble, right? And they have 9 lives. But what is its Achilles heel? Curiosity. That's its Achilles heel. And that's what the man pointed out to me. He says, it's such a powerful impulse that we can hardly resist it. So, very helpful insight there. I try to be very nice to everyone because I feel everybody probably has something for me help, and they do. Even when cars cut me off, do things in bad driving, I'm still nice to them. I say, thank you, you're probably doing that for a reason to help me. Literally, I do this. And it's how I feel because it turns out that's true. Turns out that's true. You get delayed, it turns out, oh, if I hadn't have been delayed, I would have gotten into this problem or you know, something like that. So always feel, this is what Jesus tells, always feel the Holy Spirit. Your life is just grace. It's just everything that's coming to you is the grace of God. He says, because it's literally true. Now, we don't know how this works, how this game works, but we know we like it and we know it's effective. So we don't need curiosity about how it works. We will see in hindsight what we have been given. But if we're constantly curious, there is no hindsight. It's just frustration. You say, oh, I know it's not working. What's going on? Well, we brought it out of the light. We tried to evaluate with our intellect, and so nothing evaporated. Or so we got nowhere. So I don't know what's happening with the insights I had today. I just held the reaction up to the higher, to the true self, to the Holy Spirit, true self, the oneness, the one mind, the oneness. Grace of God, just hold it up to the grace of God and let the grace of God evaporate what we're willing to have evaporated. Next time I look, I'm going to see a lot better and it's going to be easier. This is my testimony from 4 decades of working like this. This is my testimony. And you get to the mega insights today. We're so used to evaluating with our, what we call the egoic intellect, that to not do that is very, we find it very, very challenging. But, and yet if we keep evaluating with the egoic intellect, we're just spinning our wheels, we're not getting anywhere. We could do it for 1,000 decades, 100,000, whatever. We'll get nowhere. We're getting nowhere. So it is rapid progress to do it. Even 4 decades is rapid progress. Very rapid progress. Because we're so addicted. Our addiction is so severe to thinking, evaluating, and letting curiosity get the best of us. I wonder what the ego, could do with this. We don't want to know. We know what it does with us. It traps us into futility and failure. It thinks failure is a new reality. And tells us there's a way to be happy with misery, with what we don't really want at all. And there isn't any such way. And it gives us all sorts of pep talks and advice about, well, we just have to wait, it will happen for us. No, it won't. It won't happen that way. There's nothing there. The ego has nothing for us. Just an empty hope that somehow magical thinking, suffering will transform itself, and confusion, conflict will somehow become the new reality, and we'll love it. You know, we cannot love what God did not create us to love. And God did not create us to love conflict. So there's no love of conflict. We don't have love of conflict. There's a love of the creativity involved, but not the love of fear. We don't have the love of fear. We don't love fear. No, we can never love fear. We can never love conflict. Never love confusion. Never love disorientation. And not really. It's not what it'll never be what we really want. So when we do make a big push, which we should every day, there comes a point when we then just have to lift the reaction up to the grace of God and just allow the overall reaction to for the grace of God to just work upon it. And we just get to stay out of the picture and just say, okay, I'm just going to keep going in stride. I did a lot of stretching yesterday evening. A lot of stretching. Painful. It's always painful. I don't know. You get older, the muscles are painful when you stretch. But after I did all this, I was walking around and I felt very, very light and nimble. It was quite extraordinary. So, wow. Quite interesting. So, I'll try to keep doing this. It's feeling nimble on my feet is not something I'm used to feeling. And as I say, this is kind of nice. I was walking in a store and I started walking on my toes. I haven't done that in a long, long time. Speaking of 1979 and some videos, I remember the last musical group I really listened to was Blondie in Parallel Lines. It was 1979, I looked it up, yeah. And that was just before the personal computer and all this stuff happened. And I remember, I said, well, how old was I? Well, I was like 23. So I was like, you know, just a very young adult, 23. It's 3 years out, 4 years out of the teens. So I was, you know, I was super sick at the time, but still there was a youthfulness there. And I'm sort of feeling like I'm going back to that youthfulness. In some way, it's like, wow, I haven't walked like this since I was, you know, younger. Quite, just sort of smooth, and you just feel like, you know, wow, I can walk really nicely. It's fun to walk. Remember when it was fun to walk? Fun to move around? And, you know, of course we miss our youth. I was just thinking to the songs. I said, oh, I really used to love those songs. Well, we love our youth, don't we? And there's nothing wrong with that. We shouldn't stop loving our youth. Because the youthfulness is closer to what we really are in terms of we weren't so dispirited with the contamination of thinking and evaluation and the creeping inference of this world that reality is no longer real, and we feel like we can move any which way we want to move, and we feel that we'll always feel this way. So there's a feeling like we'll always feel young when we're young, right? And so this is the feeling we're getting back to. I'm feeling this. I actually have had, this is starting to dawn upon me, tinges of it. Yesterday and today, there's little tinges, like I suddenly feel like when I was young again. I remember how it felt when I was young again. Well, that's a pretty nice remembrance, isn't it? Say, oh, this, yeah, I remember how I felt. Wow, I thought I'd forget forever. No. What's that?
I don't know. A bunch of stuff came down from somewhere. From the tree. Sudden, there's no wind. I don't know what knocked it down. Maybe there's a bird up there that knocked it down.
And what I feel is just the overall sense of confidence. Some sense of confidence. Like you're sort of floating. Don't even feel the body. You can just float wherever you want to. It just functions, you know, without even trying to get it to function. Just easily functions. Now, when you try to grab a hold of those insights, it doesn't last. Then you get frustrated. So you just have to say, okay, I can accept this. I accept this. Don't try to grasp it. Refuse to grasp any insight. This is what the ego wants, to grasp it so it can reverse engineer it. See, what's the narrative here? Dissect it so it can find a narrative. Avoid looking for a narrative in any feeling we have. Avoid looking for a narrative. So what's the feeling is, the feeling about the body is like hardly being there. It doesn't seem to be dictating to us anything when we're young, and we certainly can get that feeling back again. Jesus tells us that when we are in non-dual abidance, this is how we will feel, is we won't feel the body at all. There's no impedance there. It's not telling us what to do or restricting us. We just feel we can go with the flow as we need to. He says, absolutely, you will feel perfectly well. For as long as you want to feel perfect, as long as you want to be here, you can be here and feel perfectly well. So like when you were young, where you just the body seemed to not be a trouble at all to us. So we're not going back to naivete of youth, but more of the relationship with the body, in terms of it's not an impedance. Don't have to think about it. When we're young, we often don't think about the body at all. We just feel confident that it's going to do whatever we want it to do. So we don't spend our time thinking about it, most of us. So yeah, we can feel that again. There's no narrative for the body at all. There's no narrative that when we take the demand for a narrative off of ourselves, there's no need for the body to have any narrative. It could just be perfectly well, and that's it. Perfectly well. It doesn't impede it in any way. So I'm seeing what happened with my life from the mistakes. It's very powerful to see this. I just have to say, okay, and not react. Just hold the wow up again. Well, don't struggle with the reactions. Hold the basket of reactions up. Hold the basket of reactions without looking, not peeking, not looking. So I don't need to see what's happening with it. I just let whatever dissolves, whatever evaporates, whatever. That's fine. I know I'm doing good work, so just it's going to be effective. It'll be effective. Have faith in that. Ah, there's the win. So much stuff is coming down. It's really extraordinary. I don't know. Wow. But a storm is coming in. It's coming in tonight. 1 o'clock in the morning, it should start raining. big storm, a Pacific Northwest storm, dumping huge amounts of rain and snow up there, and we're going to the North Bay of San Francisco Bay. North Bay is going to get about 2 inches of rain. The mountains in the South Bay, 1 inch, and we're at Silicon Valley, about half inch of rain. That's still pretty substantial. And we're entering now a period of about 5 days of cloudy, wet weather. We haven't had anything like this in 4 years, in terms of a real period of sort of a series of impulses of storms coming through. So we're going to get reacquainted with winter weather here, which is, I'm looking forward to it, very much so. Should be enjoyable. Now, if I didn't get started running before the rain hit, I probably have a great excuse. Say, oh, well, I can't do it, you know. But now that I've done it, I say, no, I can do it again. It doesn't matter if it rains, I can do that. I will do that again. So it's really important to get started before things get bad. This is what I have preached my whole life. Get started before things turn real bad. The weather turns bad. And the weather in this world, the sociological weather, ideological weather, etc., in this world, is about to turn real bad in 2016. The tension in 2015 ratcheted up to exponentially in a lot of ways, actually. It really did. We're in a whole different mode now. We realize, uh-oh, what are we in for? The realization's dawning upon us. Uh-oh. We're really cooked now, aren't we? And it seems, well, we know, by design. So then in 2016, the frog is in the pot, and the frog has realized, hey, it's getting real hot in the pot. And suddenly it gets too hot, and the frog is trying to jump at it. So once it gets too hot, the frog, it saps its energy. Something it can't jump so well. So the frog better jump out of the pot before it gets too hot. In cool water, the frog can jump. When it gets warm and tepid and warmer and warmer, the frog gets sluggish. Oh, I can't really jump so well. And then it's cooked. You know, can't get out. So we had better jump out of the pot before it gets too hot. And 2016 is going to get too hot. Now the grace of God may do something about it. May help have some that help cool it down so the frog can still jump out of the pot. Most people, though, just listen to the ego. The ego never gives them the proper warning, the proper preparation. Never, 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 never. Just spins the wheels. It's a shame. It's a tragedy. But there's no way to cure this tragedy except this patience, this faith. And lift the reactions to our progress up to grace and let the grace take care of it. There isn't any other way. The ego will give us a million other ways. It will give us a million options except this one option. It will not give us this option. Which is why you so rarely hear about it. There's so many, many, many options that seem to be constantly swirling around in the world. But this is the one option that seems to be the least emphasized here. This is what I have found out. The ego always tries to interfere. Says, no, I can figure it out. Let me look at the basket of reaction. I can figure this. No, 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 no. It cannot. It only makes it worse. It starts splitting and dissecting and dividing and quantifying and evaluating illusions. And it just pulls you down into this tar pit. Quicksand, quicksand, quicksand. The ego just makes quicksand out of whatever it touches. It has to. It represents the voice of fear, of the fear of reality, that reality isn't real anymore, or that it's no more. A new reality is dawned. This is what the ego tells us. It's denial of reality is the new reality. So the ego's frantic to avoid what really helps and works. Awakens us to reality again. Awakens us back to awareness. Pure awareness. Nature of awareness. Whatever you want to call it. Nature of knowingness. Beingness. Isness. Nowness. So my golf ball should arrive tomorrow, and what it is no excuses. I mean, this best golf balls in the world. I mean, I don't care what anybody says. They keep saying, "Well, this one and this one." And no, I've tried them all. The reason why we try different golf balls is it's an excuse. Well, I'm trying a different golf ball. Well, it doesn't quite do what I want it to do. You know, blah blah blah. It's a great excuse. The whole golf industry is built on excuses and providing excuses for all of us golfers. I'm trying out a new driver. I'm trying out a new set of clubs. I'm trying this golf ball. So, well, I'm trying this equipment. Maybe I'm evaluating this, evaluating that. It's never me. It's never the Indian. It's always the arrow. They're trying this at different arrow. So I said, let me just get the best, and there's no more excuses. It's me. If it doesn't work, it's me. It's me. And it's true. It's true. I got some great help from this man that I played golf with a while ago, and he's a baseball coach, and he said, "Look, you're tipping forward a little bit on your swing," and he was right. I was dipping my weight too far, and I was tipping, and I was missing the sweet spot. He said, "That's all you're doing wrong. Your swing's good. You're just tipping forward. I was losing my balance." And since then, I realized it's me. I have to get better balance. And so I've been working on that. Working on strengthening my overall balance. And there's no shortcut to this. You just have to keep working at it. Oh, I did squats for the first time since I was young, I think. I haven't done any squats. We used to do it in PE class. Where you just squat down and then get up, keep your back straight. I did 10 of them. I haven't been able to do a single one for a long, long time. I said, I don't know if I'll really do them again. Today I said, let me try it. I did one. I said, wow, I did a squat. Then I was able to do 10 of them. I said, oh my gosh, this is really something. For some reason, those are not easy to do. If you can do them, it's a sign that you got some strength and balance going on in your body. So it's not the arrow, it's the Indian. And balance is key to it. You cannot lose your balance. You have to be able to keep balance and confidence with your balance. So I know that the D-Day is arriving, and that's these golf balls. I won't have no more excuse. If I don't hit it far, that's on me. If I don't hit it straight, it's on me. If I don't do it right, it's on me. Which is a good thing. It's a good thing to be challenged in this way. I believe this is why we don't have we don't have spiritual teachers, the ones that really, really, really stand out, and we say, wow, I know this one represents the best that can be. Because we want to keep blaming our teachers. We want to keep saying, maybe it's not me, maybe it's the teacher. This is true. It's the same thing as golfers. We don't want to admit it's us because we're out of shape. We're out of spiritual shape. And we don't think we can get in shape. So we say, well, it's the teacher. I'll go to this one. I'll go to that one. I'll go, oh, this is not quite. So we kind of have, I mean, not these teachers are not bad that we have in the world. But they're not quite up to the standard, the highest standard, I would say. I would put it that way. There is something that just feels like it's just a higher echelon. It's just, you know, that we've had a couple of them. Last century, we had a number of them. So we're in this mode now where, again, we can, the doubts of maybe it's the teacher. Maybe it's the teacher. And we'd like that. We don't want these really great teachers because then it's all on us, right? And we think, well, I can't do it then. It's too difficult. Well, for me, I'm trying to get through that, this issue, and say, no, it's not the teacher. It's me. It can't be the teacher. It has to be me. So we try to celebrate these teachers who are maybe less than what we really deserve, thinking that, oh, that's helpful because maybe it's not all me. Of course, a real teacher is really telling you, it's all you. Yeah, it is you. You're the one who has to reach abidance, accept non-dual abidance. You're not doing it yet. It's so everything is on you. And say it in the right way, in the right way, so that we recognize this is true. And don't act out it. Don't, you know, we put pressure on the teachers to act out so they can seem to have feet of clay. So that we can say, well, maybe it's them and not me. Put so much pressure on the teachers here. You really do. Because we want to fail. We're so scared. We don't recognize, we don't know how to manage our success. So we're afraid of success. It seems overwhelming to us. We're still too much in quantitative analysis and materialism, and we don't have enough faith in the grace of God and trust. So we want an excuse to fail, but we don't want to admit that. So we want to have teachers that seem like they're, help us, but we end up failing. We say, oh, it was their fault. Okay, that's why I failed. But at least I failed. We say, oh, okay, I'm comfortable with my failure. It's what I'm used to. So we try to avoid these great teachers. We try to avoid them. This is unfortunately the truth. And I keep wondering, why can't I have communication with these teachers? Well, I'm avoiding them. It's not their fault. Can't be their fault. It has to be my fault. Remember, what we are, perfection doesn't have any narrative, doesn't need a narrative, doesn't have any. So when we keep feeling, getting closer to this perfection, feeling it, we think, oh, but, okay, well, what's the narrative of this? How can I advance this narrative? We keep applying it as if this is motivating us to advance the narrative, where the whole path is to drop the narrative. We don't need to advance any narrative, actually. Ultimately, it's that what we are has no narrative at all. It's the base. The base doesn't have a narrative. The base is where all narratives arise and fall, all appearancing rises and falls without changing the base at all. What narrative does pure spaciousness have? It doesn't have any. This is what Longchenpa keeps emphasizing. It doesn't have any narrative. It never will. It's impartial. Now, these golf balls are used, but they're in like new condition. Because if I tried to get new ones, the price would have been so so high. Maybe even though they're on sale now, right now. But the price, I just felt like so high. I'd hate to lose them. I probably wouldn't even use them. I said, I just can't stand to lose this. It's too much. Too much pressure. I said, well, at least these are used. I said, okay, I lose them. Okay, it's not that big of a deal. But they're really, I expect them to be like new condition, really, really like new condition. And these new golf balls, Pro V1Xs, they are supposed to be super durable. There's a new paint system they use, Titleist uses, to keep this bright white color for much, much longer. That was the 213s are that way. Because part of the problem is these golf balls, they faded, the white faded. You find like an old one somewhere in the bushes and you can look at it, it's like, oh wow, it's really lost its white color, kind of, it's faded quite a bit. It looks old. Where now that it stays bright white and the durability is way, way greater. So they say these are some of the most durable golf balls there are. But they're super high performance. So There's no excuse to lose him. You can play two rounds with him. I think Jordan Spieth said that when he won the Australian Open in 2015, he shot a 63. He says the best round of his life. He was using Pro V1X. And he said, that in 2015 one, he said, I used the same golf ball the entire round. And he said it behaved perfectly the entire round. Now, this is quite extraordinary. Usually the pros, they change their golf ball out maybe halfway through or every so often. They usually don't play the whole round with the same golf ball. But he played the same in any best round of his life. It was just extraordinary. He played the whole season with the Pro V1X, the new one. So it behaves. There's no excuse. I mean, if he can play that well with that golf ball, I'll be using the exact same golf ball. There's no excuse at all. Bubba Watson, same thing. Used the golf ball. He's been playing great. No excuse. That's good. So if we can bring ourselves to the level of no excuse, this is really good progress. It means we're feeling like, hey, I can work on my game. I can work on my spiritual game. I'm willing to do it. I'm willing to try. I'm willing to say no excuses. Must be a lot of wind aloft. I don't know. No excuses. So, and it seems true to me that we're in a time now where everybody wants excuses. So it's like nobody wants a really great teacher here. They really don't want it. So it's very difficult to be that way here. Very difficult. I can see the potential to do it, but nobody wants it. Just like I'm noticing in the golf market, so many people now are trying alternative golf balls to the Pro V1s, Pro V1Xs, save a little bit of money. Well, this one's just as good. Oh, yeah, I'm going to try this one. And I mean, TaylorMade makes a good ball. TaylorMade Tour Preferred X. There's some top players using that, top players in the world. But the attitude is, oh, I can't afford them. They're too expensive. I'm going to use something else just as good. They say there's a lot. What you hear a lot of is say, well, there's a lot of golf balls that are just as good, but half the price. Well, guess what? They're not just as good. They're not just as good. I've tried them. They're not just as good. They give an excuse. Well, it's the golf ball. Yeah, this is why I'm not playing so well. Titleist has done a great job. They put a lot of effort in. They make the best golf ball in the world. And you pay for it, but for some reason they discounted now. It's very rare, Christmas time. But so the world is such that it's the mood, the attitude of the world is, hey, I can get the same thing at half the price. I'd say, well, I could, this teacher here is just as good, and I don't have to. I can work half as put half the effort into it, and it'll be fine. It's not quite true. It's not quite true. It's true that the Titleist, what they say, that the whole overall game, when I've used the Pro V1, it's true I score better. It is true. I've noticed this. But for some reason, you lose it, you get upset. But the Pro V1 doesn't go quite as far off the driver, so that's why I got the Pro V1X. Because you always want more distance, and sometimes it doesn't seem to fly as far as you want. And you think, oh, if I had some. But overall, somehow you end up scoring better with it. This is a truism. That's why 3,000 pros around the world use the Titleist Pro V1 1X series. 3,000 golf pros around the world, professional, make their living playing golf. They use it because overall, it does reduce scoring. It gives a better score. This is true. This is a truism. So, the great teachers overall, they're going to give a better result. But we keep looking for discounts. I notice people now are fanatic about discounts. I see people with their smartphones in the grocery stores. They're just scanning everything. They look, then they look at their phone, and then they shake their head and say, ah. Everybody's looking for the bargain, the discount, to show how smart they are. So even if there's a great teacher, they'd say, I think I can do better with this one over here. It's less demanding of me. I got the same results, but less demanding, less intense. And so this egoic smartness, the ego loves to be smart in a certain way, quantitatively smart. Look for the egoic bargain instead of wisdom, wisdom, wisdom. So the pressure's on me. Don't lose that golf ball. It's really on me. And I say, wow, that's quite a challenge. I really got to buckle down here. Can't be sloppy. Can't be stupid. So it is a challenge. When you get a great teacher, it's a challenge. You say, well, I can't blow this. I really got to succeed here. I can't mess around anymore. I can't waste time. I can't fail here. This, because this is the best teacher there is. And if I fail here, that's really going to make me feel like I can never do it. I can't fail here. I say, So I'm working on my, for example, working on my balancing, and I just keep working at it. I just keep working at it and get stronger and stronger and stronger. I keep trying to do new exercises of just, you know, stand on one leg like this. Just increase your balance. Work on your balance. They say that one of the best cures, avoidance, preventative for Alzheimer's is balance exercises. Maybe that's why a lot of older people play golf, because you have to keep working on your balance. If you just sit in front of a TV, this is a problem. Because balancing seems to has to engage all the muscles of the body. You're balancing. You can't just throw off the balance. Nothing can throw off the balance. You have to stay balanced. And it's work. It's work. So spiritual balance is the same thing. Keeping your spiritual balance. You have to keep working on it. It's like a workout every day. Now, another reason, got the Pro V1X. They say nothing sounds better off the club face. If you hit it really good, it's got the best sound of any ball there is. I believe that. Yeah. And with this driver I have now, it also drivers, it's they've conformed it to sound like a persimmon wood. And I hit one recently just right, and my gosh, what a sound. It just reverberated through it. Just, wow, it was fabulous. So the combination of the ball and the club are going to produce, I know, just a fabulous sound. No doubt about it. And a lot of golf should be aesthetics, actually, the aesthetics of it all. It's not really about the scoring. It's only partly about that. It's just the overall aesthetics. The overall experience. The overall experiencing. So I'm trying to get back to that and try to be more, care about it more. Because reality is just the experiencing. It's the overall experiencing. It's not quantitative analysis. How does it feel? What's the essence of it? What's the essence? Athletes always work on their core, their core, their core, their core. So we're working here, spiritual athletes, working on the core. The core, keep working on the core, which is this faith in the grace of God. A sneeze just built up, very strong, and I thought I was going to lose it. And at the last second, I said, I absolutely cannot lose this. I will not do it. And then it ended up reverberating throughout me. It's like, whoa. But it took a complete commitment there. Right at the last second, I said, I have to commit completely to this, or I'm going to sneeze. So this is a very good example of a spiritual path. At some point, we really feel, I have to commit completely to this. I really have to commit to this. Commit to the grace. Keep commit to this. I'm going to let the grace of God evaporate. Just put everything I can possibly put up. Just put it all up in this basket and let the Holy Spirit filter it. So it's like there's this basket in our head, and we just keep putting, there's this picking the fruits and say, okay, just whatever I can pick, let me just put it all up there. And then at the end, it'll just be the fruit that I really want. It will be there. It's a hard time. We can't really sort it out here. We're so confused and so have so many bad habits, so much continuity fear. Trying to sort it out is a losing game. Wear my jacket this time. It's better. I can hang in here. It's not so cold because the storm's coming in. After the storms, it'll get cold. Going to be very cool going towards Christmas. So when the full stop in the wow, that includes not worrying about reactions others will have, or positive success we'll have. Say, I'm not going to evaluate success or failure or negativity, either positivity or negativity. I'm not going to evaluate, I'm just staying in the wow. That's maybe the most difficult, is you think, oh, I could really, great, I think I'm finally going to get, okay, what am I going to do with this? And then you start to find out that you suddenly start finding reactions of other people rejecting it, making it difficult. You say, oh, then you start struggling with it. You just say, no, I will not do this. I will just rely on the grace of God to evaporate, and then I'll find out, hindsight will show me what I really have. I can't really evaluate how am I going to function unless I really know what I have. And right now, I don't really know what I truly have. So no evaluation that way. I got the gutters clean, so I'm not worried about the rain. Let it rain, let it pour. See, this is the thing. You do the work ahead of time. I saw the gutters. They're clean. So let it pour. I believe they're clean. I'm just thinking of it. Did I forget any of them? I might have. But I'll do one more check. I'm thinking. Yeah, there, I might have to. I might have to do a little more checking. Maybe not. Anyway, it's a great feeling to know that you're prepared. And so you say, I don't care how much it rains. You know, the gutters can handle it. So if we're prepared, it doesn't matter how negative the world gets. We can handle it. Let whatever negative, we don't have to evaluate the negativity. It's water off a duck's back. We can handle it. It's not going to get to us. So I continue not to follow any stories, not to react to anything that's happening. Just stay in the wow. Trying to accept a great teacher here in this world, or great teachers here. No excuse for failure. Now, we can still fail, but we realize it's us. And so that helps us out a lot. Say, wow, I'm still, you know, I still have to do work to do, but that's helpful. That's helpful. It's not a bad thing at all. If I hit the golf ball, it doesn't work. Not good. I say, well, that's me. I still have to keep working. Great. It's just that I'm not looking for a magical solution anymore. Like, oh, if I just get this golf ball, everything's going to work great. No, just get the best one there is and then see how it goes. And then you know that you have work to do. It'll point out to you what work you have to do. Another thing I'm noticing is you get more flexible in shape. You don't feel like you have to force things, swing too hard. It feels smooth and easy, and you don't have to try to overdo it. Whereas if you're really out of shape, you feel, I really got to put a lot of effort into this and just, you know, because I have to force it. Because it's not coming easy. If it comes easy, the less we have to force it. So this is why I guess I think the great teachers, it all seems easy. They're just flowing, and they're not trying to force anything because it's so easy for them. So it's paradoxical. The better shape we get, the less we think we really have to force anything. I don't really have to force it. I'm doing fine. Just doing great. This is how we were when we were young, right? It's easy. I don't have to try and see the adults try to force it. We say, why do I have to do that? I just not naturally just nice and easy. And it's not difficult. Then you just stay in the flow. So I'm not trying to force anything to happen. Just it's easy for it to happen. I think this is the way the teachers, the great teachers are, I would say. They're in great spiritual shape, immaculate shape. And, you know, if we want to have good trainers, this is what we need. If we want to get in really great shape, you need really wise trainers who are not just these dinosaurs saying, well, you just got to keep doing what we've done before and that's it. Well, get the best techniques, the best teachings, the best practices so that we really, really thrive. We want to thrive. We want to thrive. We want to succeed. We want to thrive. We don't want to fail. We want to really get it. We really, really want to get it in a vibe. We really want to succeed. We really want to succeed. So much so that we're already thanking the Holy Spirit for our success. I guess I already know I've already succeeded. Yes, I already know I've already succeeded. Yes, I know I can succeed. Yes, I know I will succeed. Yes, I know I've already succeeded. Truth is, but when we stop evaluating where we are completely, we'll realize that we're already here. So this wow is very helpful. Because what Longchenpa said is in the knowing, in this non-dualness, there's no need for evaluation. You are it. It's not objectified. There's not some objectification that needs to be evaluated at all. We are the being. We are the being. We are that. Not something is that. We literally are the being itself. Not being something, just the being. We are the beingness. We are the beingness. Now, you could say we're in virtuoso training. We're training to be spiritual virtuosos. It's a, those who don't want to succeed at that, they cannot understand. They can't get with it. They say, well, I can do some other trade. It's good enough. I just want to learn to play the piano. Well, we want to be virtuosos. That's what's, because the self is the virtuoso. It is virtuosity. That's what it is. So if we're not virtuosos, we have to avoid what we are. And in order to do that, we have to trust in the ego. And trusting in the ego is insidious. It's trusting in delay, but it's insidious inference builds up as a continuity issue that we believe reality is no more. And so when we decide, okay, I'm tired of the ego, oops, guess what? Continuity fear suddenly hits us like a brick wall. Oh my gosh, what's that? So it's not the way I want everyone to be spiritual virtuosos, because that is what we all actually are, already are. This is what we are. It's unavoidable. We have to be this. We have to be what we are. We can't be less than what we are. That then involves trying to believe in we have to change reality, which then brings about this insidious fear, continuity fear, very insidious. And you don't realize how bad it is until you decide, okay, I'm tired of the ego, this is it. Okay, I'm going to be a spiritual virtuoso again, I'm not going to be less than what I am. And then boom, what's this? Well, what in the world? This shock of fear hits us, dread. It's like, you can't go back to reality, we got rid of it. Like, uh-oh, what? What happened? I don't want to, it's insidious buildup of this continuity fear. So we all have to be virtuosos. Let's all be virtuosos. We have no choice. So this training is for everyone, ultimately, but bit by bit, not everyone tends to do it all at the same time. We don't all seem to. We just, you know, there are some that right now it's time, and for others later on they will decide. So you cannot explain this virtuoso training to someone who's not in the training. But those who are in the training, they understand, they can get it. It's relevant to them. Those who are not the training, they say, oh, it's not really relevant because I'm not going to do it because I don't want to succeed. I want to fail. I want to keep failing so the continuity fear doesn't bite me. If we feel there's something inside that's going to bite us, so we want to keep failing. And it's the continuity fear. So when we try to succeed, we feel the continuity fear. We get bitten by it. And we say, ah, like a mosquito. Well, worse than that. But, and we say, I want to avoid that at all costs. Well, then we better start working on evaporating it. Because just continuing to fail, it just makes it worse and it keeps biting us. This is what I know. So I wish everyone in the world knows this. It would save them unbelievable suffering and misery. They just could hear this, but they're afraid to even look at truth at all. But this isn't directly looking at truth. This is just looking at the defenses and the trouble. So it's not as difficult as we would think. That this insidious inference that reality by believing in time, space, process, and form. Insidious inference that reality is no more. And then we say, but I was just playing, and I didn't really mean for it to be real. And we think, oh my gosh, what did I do? We feel then, oh my gosh, I've destroyed reality. This is horrible. No, we've just built up all this inference. It's just inferring it. But our creativity, the play of our creativity is so extraordinary that the inference seems very strong. And yet, it is still merely an inference. No truth to it at all. Hurry up and wait. Sunday girl by the Blondie here. Hurry up and wait. I got da-da-da. Like, hurry up and wait. Hurry up and wait. That's what we're doing now. Hurry up and wait. Hurry up and wait. I got the blues. Hurry up and wait. That's how we do it. To hurry up, we are patient and allow the evaporation, let grace evaporate the wow reaction. It's the one thing that those who fail don't do. It's the one thing that they don't do. They say, well, I don't have the patience for that. I shouldn't have to do that. I'm a virtuoso. Well, yeah, but the continuity fear gets in the way. They say, well, I shouldn't have continuity fear. Yeah, well, our creativity is so extraordinary that it's caused this inference situation. It's brought up this inference. And we're so familiar with this fear and inference. We have this severe continuity problem. Well, I shouldn't have that. Well, we do. Everyone does. It's not a sign of stupidity. It's a sign of stupendous creativity, actually. So our creativity has worked against us in this way. And you say, well, I got to get rid of the creativity. No, we can't. It's not possible. So there is only the spiritual path is possible. It's the only way out. And many take great acceptance at this. Ah, I shouldn't have to do that. Well, that's the same way. So we're all the same way. I shouldn't have to do that. I should be able to get, you know, drop this right now. I should be able to get free. Come on. I don't need this path. I can do it right now. I should be able to do it right now. This plays into everyone's ego. I mean, it's spiritual pride, fast food spirituality. Oh, yeah, I should be able to do it right now. It doesn't work that way. So it's very humbling. Spiritual path is very humbling. Every day is very humbling because I think, wow, I mean, I still can't do it. Wow, this is really extraordinary. I'm still afraid to do it. And those who don't take the path, they say, Dad, I should be able to do it. I'll just wait until the ego will take care of this somehow. I know there's some magical way to get deals. I'm not going to humiliate myself by taking some long path. No way. Not for me. I'm way too smart for that. This is the attitude of the world. This is everyone who doesn't take the spiritual path has this attitude of spiritual pride that they shouldn't have to do it. And I just, through suffering, I had to. So, you know, really, I know how difficult it is for everyone. They just won't do it. They just refuse to do it. They say, I shouldn't have to do this. I'm better than that. It's beneath me. It's beneath me. I'll get a servant to do that. I'll get a slave to do that for me. I'm not going to do it. Well, guess what? None of us are slaves or servants. None of us will do it. If from pride, from the standpoint of pride, no way. No way they won't do it. So, yeah, we have to realize that the resistance is really coming from our awesome creativity. It's testimony to how awesome we really are. So it shouldn't be a prideful thing. It shouldn't cause us to feel indignant. We should say, oh, okay, wow. I was over adventurous. It's testimony to my extraordinary adventurous spirit, fearless adventurous spirit, and massive, you know, incredible creativity that I even thought that I could change reality, that I even thought that I could make magical belief work. And then I made all this, imagined all this stuff that brings about all this inference. This is just an extraordinary effort on my part to cause this issue, to bring about this issue. So therefore, I can forgive myself for this. I can forgive myself for working on this. I don't feel, ashamed to do it. I don't. I don't. This is a great undertaking, and I'll look back and say, wow. In hindsight, say that was just. It was because of how perfect I am that I was able to even concoct this effort to try and change what I am. And so you don't feel so abased or ashamed or humiliated on the path. You don't really feel that way because you know you're going to succeed at it. And this is the toughest thing there is to succeed at it. This is, well, it's the only success there is, and it's temporary, but it's the greatest challenge, you might say. So to take on this greatest challenge, this is a laudatory, very laudatory. So it's not contemptuous at all. No, it's laudatory. There's nothing more difficult. And it results in this stupendous success of realizing our inherent perfection. So it's just win, 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 is all it is. I still don't know what's good. It's so dark, I can't know what's coming down and crashing down. I just don't get it. Three to five feet of snow in the Cascades, something like that, just with this one storm. There's one storm. You don't want to be out in this storm. It's going to pack a punch up north. Not going too far south. Just brushing the South Bay kind of area, this area. Not going too far south. There's a very strange noise there in the distance. I don't know what that is. Turkeys? They should be asleep by this time. So of course we expect ourselves to be spiritual virtuosos. There's no escaping it. It's inescapable. This is our fate. Because that's how we were created. We still are this. We cannot escape our fate this way. We cannot escape our fate of being a spiritual virtuoso. It's impossible. So all these dreams that somehow we're going to escape and find some halfwayness and just stay there forever is not true. Not true. It'll never happen that way. We must go all the way home to our spiritual virtuosity. Perfect. No escape from it. For those who are delayed, they're just merely delaying. That's it. That's it. That's it. It's just delay. Meaningless delay. There's no meaning to it. Doesn't result in an impermanency of delay. Does not. And our spiritual perfection keeps cropping up somehow. We keep noticing, oh, I noticed this, notice. Say, huh. Can't escape it. We keep trying to dull ourselves down to escape it. That's why people spend all their time fear. Dull themselves down to try to escape it. Now, when you're working out, you feel sore. When you're doing the spiritual path, you're accepting your inherent perfect spiritual perfection. You got to feel the wow. It was wow. It's like spiritual soreness. I feel. You have to keep stretching, stretching your mind out. There's no escape from. But there's no escape from this. We have to do it. No escape from it. You have to do it. Eventually, everyone will have to do it. So it's not like we're doing something that others won't have to do. They have to do it too. They're just bragging, like, well, I'm not going to do it now. Well, you know, I'm going to die. I'm going to avoid escape. No. There's no escaping our spiritual virtuosity. We cannot escape our spiritual perfection through death. It's ridiculous to think we can do it that way. After death, we experience after death realms, but, and we think, oh, I can stay here forever. Yeah, this is good enough. It's not good enough. It's not good enough. And then the ego advises us another birth to try to reject reality. I think, okay, well, that maybe that has to work, and it goes on and on. So, hurry up and wait. That's how to hurry up. Patience with the wow. Avoid the curiosity. Avoid curiosity. Be conscious of your curiosity and say, no, not going to do that. Don't be impulsive. This world tries to play to our curiosity and impulsiveness through packaging. Oh, I'm curious about this. Oh, I'm curious about that. I wonder what. I say, no. I'm at the checkout stand. I say, oh, I wonder, look at those drinks there, energy drink. I'm curious. How would that, you know, what would that taste like? Or how would that affect me? Or how would this. No. That's, I'm doing fine. I'm in the wow. I'm not going to experiment, do any sort of curiosity experiments here. I know I'm doing what's right. So just keep doing it. What would I feel like if I took this drug? What would I feel like if this? No. We have to know what it feels like to feel the wow, and then use our faith to place it in the hands of the grace of God to evaporate continuity, fear, and evaporate what we don't really want. And we have to be very keen about recognizing this to be spiritual virtuosos. We must be very keen on, very much so. So we cannot be under the influence of drugs. Hurry up and wait. Waiting is the way to hurry up. It's the way to go faster, actually. But if what I found is, like, if you use caffeine, is you go real fast for a while, and then there's a crash, and you just can't, you feel sluggish for like a week or so, and ultimately you then are back right where you started, and you lose the momentum, and so it actually makes you go much, much slower, which is what most of us want, right? Because we don't know how to manage our success, so we want to go slow, we want to fail. And so we have these excuses. Well, I use caffeine, that's why I'm failing. That's why. No, we're failing because of our continuity fear and not being wise enough about not trusting in the grace of God enough. So we say, thank you, Holy Spirit, for the wonderful experiencing that you have for in front of me that I'm about to move into. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for just this tremendously beautiful and quote-unquote youthful, but almost like floatingness of no hindrance, this feeling of unhinderedness, this wonderful unhindered feeling. I There's just nothing standing in our way, nothing hindering us, no hindrance, the feeling of no hindrance at all. Just nothing to prove, no narrative to pursue. So we thank the Holy Spirit for that. As we try on this new suit of clothes, as it were, no hindrance. The ease, absolute ease. We're at ease. So we thank the Holy Spirit for bringing us this sense of miraculous ease. No narrative to it. No base to it. It is the base. So there's no base to it. This is the base. The base doesn't have a base. The base is the base. It's not looking for a base. It's not looking for reassurance. It is the base. So this baseless ease, because this ease is the base. So this baseless ease, this no narrative baseless ease, arising from nowhere, going nowhere, staying nowhere. So instead of petitioning, just say thank you for because you already have it for me. The Holy Spirit already has this for us. So thank you, Holy Spirit, for having this for me. It's not something the Holy Spirit has to acquire. We don't need to wait for the Holy Spirit to get this. It's had it concurrently with our attempt to change what we are. Concurrent with that, the Holy Spirit has this perfect ease for us, set in time, set in illusion, as it were. But concurrent with our desire to entertain illusions, concurrent with that arose this sense of perfect ease within that. The sense of perfect ease. We don't need this. The senses that we have now are not important. The eyesight, hearing, all that stuff. The sense that we really want is the sense of perfect ease. The Holy Spirit has that sense for us, has always had it for us. Concurrent with our attempt to change what we are. Not afterwards, not as an afterthought, like, gee, I wonder what happened. No, concurrent with it. Simultaneously concurrent with it. The sense of ease, the sense of ease. This baseless, traceless, non-narrative sense of ease, narrative-free sense of ease. This is a narrative sense, narrative-free sense of ease. It's a new sense that we have. Holy Spirit has had it waiting for us all this, ever since the beginning of our belief in time, space, process, and form. It's always had it. So thank you, Holy Spirit, for always having this for me. I forgive myself for thinking that I was waiting on you to develop this for me. That was blaming, you know, trying to blame you instead of the fault was mine for trying to change reality. It's not the arrow, it's the Indian. It's not the golf ball, it's the golfer. The sense of ease, the sense of ease. This is what we're going for. Great. A new sense that we have. Look at it this way. We have a new sense. The sense of ease. How about that? I've never heard of this before, but I love it. These people ask, what happened? I have this new sense, a sense of ease. I didn't know it was, I had available to me. We've just been rejecting it. We say, no, we have these five of the body senses. That's all we need. But no, we actually have this other sense called the sense of ease. And I now have this sense of ease. Wow. This is a great breakthrough here. Looking at it in this way, it's a different way to look at everything, isn't it? All thanks to the Holy Spirit, who it is not something I've manufactured or developed. It's always been there for us. It's just that we have thought, oh, we don't need that. Our magical thinking is going to work. The Holy Spirit's always had the sense of ease for us, since concurrently with our belief in time. With our belief in dis-ease as a magical way to change what we are. Dis-ease. That's a sense too we've been having, isn't it? The sense of dis-ease. Well, we have a sense of ease. So trade the sense of dis-ease in for the sense of ease. Okay, so by tomorrow the rain will have come, and probably showers in the evening, and it'll be a different feel to everything. Everything will be dripping and rainy and stuff. But we have this sense of ease now. We've made a breakthrough here. So all the effort today to full stop in the wow resulted in this breakthrough. That's why I was just patient, really patient today. So I just got to be patient today. I know it. And this is the hallmark of success: is patience. Positive patience, knowing that it's right there, but don't try to grab it. Just let it come to you. Let it come to you. The fish wants to come in. Just let the fish come in. The fish will come in. Don't try to force it. The fish will come in. The insight will come. It will arrive. I have this sense of ease. No non-narrative sense of ease. There's no narrative. It's been there since the beginning. There's no narrative of development of the sense at all. See, this is very crucial. There's no narrative to this sense at all. It's there. It has been there concurrently with our detour into fear. Never had any narrative to it. Just then they're waiting. Just the narrative of waiting, the Holy Spirit. Well, it's just always there. Fresh, clean, pure sense of ease is always there. And since it's a sense of ease, it never has never suffered from patiently being there. There's always been a sense of ease about it. Okay. Very great. That should do it. Okay. Now we have the wow of the sense of ease. And this is a wow. Okay, let's lift it up. Don't try to grasp it. Just say, okay, I've seen it. This is what the Holy Spirit has for us. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for having the sense of ease for us. And just feel gratitude towards that. Now we've done that. Now this new insight, is this breakthrough has happened. Now I just have to let it settle in.
He'll go running out of the street, past every house, screaming at everyone, "Wake up, wake up, wake up. I just discovered the answer for all of us." I don't think they'd like that, right? I mean, I'd love to do it, but people are too fearful for that kind of situation. Only in cartoons, I guess. Can we do that? But I'm saying it right now to everyone. Wake up, wake up, wake up. The answer has been discovered. Wow. So I can say that there's this reverberation just going through me, kind of just like a spiritual earthquake. Not more intense than any before, because I'm used to the, you know, used to, so, but it is intense. It is intense, but not too much so. Certainly, though, it is reacting. It's a new high water mark of clarity here, a big breakthrough. Now, once you have like a huge breakthrough like this, that's it. I mean, you got to take a break. I mean, as far as, don't get greedy and say, okay, now I have this. Now what do I do next? Just say, wow, this is profound. This is very, very profound. Not just for me, for you, for everybody. This is a game changer for everybody. Actually, the clarity around this, the whole world has just changed. Actually. In the big picture, maybe in the short term it doesn't seem that way, but in the long term it has. It has absolutely changed. Our outlook has changed now. Connected the dots, been able to connect all these dots, and suddenly the picture emerges. Oh my gosh, this is tremendously great news. This trumps all the bad news. Totally, totally trumps it. It's like, don't need to worry about it anymore. My gosh, this is fantastic news. So I'm like the newscaster who delivers the fantastically good news. It's true. It's true. These videos are like newscasts, actually, delivering the gospel, the good news. The great good news. The awesome news. I told the Holy Spirit I'll do it. I told Jesus I'll do it. Broadcast the good news. We thank YouTube for giving us the opportunity to do this. Seriously. Because all of them will benefit too, ultimately. Everybody benefits from this.
Nobody wants to shut out truth entirely, really. Nobody really wants, none of us, the ego does. But because that's just a reflection of fear. And we want the fear to be pure fear. But nobody really wants to shut out the truth entirely. There's always a part of everyone that's open to the truth. They say, yeah, I have a little bit of willingness. Everyone has a little bit of willingness here. So we're not condemning anyone here at all, because no one deserves condemnation. We all have a little willingness to get started and to hear the truth, and that grows and grows and grows and grows and grows eventually. We all have perfect standing in reality, every one of us. We can never lose it. So it's very, very good that YouTube has this service here, and they tend to be to allow different viewpoints on here. It's helped everyone. It's helped everyone. It's given a forum, a place for me to broadcast this, express it. Now, I could broadcast it. It's being mentally broadcast over the whole world right now, this breakthrough here. But this puts at least some format to it that we're used to, like this. So it's helpful. YouTube has never bothered me, never harassed me, bothered me in any way, really. No. So we'll take that. We'll take it. Well, the taking is good. Of course, I've admonished the side trip of technology. I've admonished all that. Not that we can't find some good use for it, like this is a good use for it. But everyone really wants the truth. They really want to know. In spite of appearances. And I let the news carry the day. It's not about me. It's about the great good news of the Holy Spirit. And it's not easy to deliver this news. You go into shock. As delivering the news, go into shock about it. I couldn't deliver it if I thought about it ahead of time, because I'd start struggling and thinking about it. So it just happens spontaneously, but then the shock comes up. It's like, wow, this is quite shockingly great news. You think, well, why didn't we get this good news before? Same reason why we're scared of perfect teachers. And even when the perfect teachers come, we say, I don't want to succeed. Like, I want to kind of fail. I'm not really sure I want to succeed. But we're under so much pressure now that we really feel we have to succeed now. It's almost, it feels like imperative. So I'd say we have more willingness now than ever here to entertain the best news possible. Because the alternative, we realize, uh-oh. Before they said, there's plenty of room in the world. We can always go somewhere. Not anymore, is there? It's totally global. Everything is totally global. And the bureaucracy is totally global. And the demands are totally global. No one's going to be untouched by it. There's nowhere you can go. And we realize, uh-oh. We better find this sense of ease. We better accept this sense of ease. Otherwise, we're like a frog in the pot. We're cooked. There isn't anywhere more for the frog to go. Before, the frog said, well, I was caught over here, but I can go over here. It's a little cool over here. But now the flame's on every area of the pot. The flame is being turned up on every area of the pot. The frog says, well, let me wander over here. Oh, my gosh, it's hot. Too hot over here. Let me go over here. Oh, it's too hot here. Then the frog starts to realize, oh, I think it's hot everywhere. And then this frog says, what do I do? And then better have the sense of ease, which cools everything down perfectly. Smoothed out coolness. Wow. Smoothed out sense of ease. It's the only remedy for the frog in the pot. And we are the frog in the pot right now. It's unquestionable, right? I'm sure there's some of you viewing this who realize it's unquestionable. Unquestionably, we're the frog in the pot. There's no doubt about it.
Even Californians have to realize this now, don't they? Says, oh my gosh, we thought it was cool over here in California, but it's the frogs in the pot over here. It's hot over here too. The heat's here too. Yeah, California, cool. We always thought we could avoid, you know, there's some place where the frog can go, where it's cool. Not anymore. That's why when all these great days of weather, we had 4 years of the most astonishing weather, probably in the history of this planet. It was so amazing. I was working so hard on the spiritual path, taping. I said, I cannot just say this is always going to be cool here. I mean, as far as the threat, the sense of imperilment, all this. No, it's going to reach here too. It's going to be everywhere. So I didn't just loaf around. I didn't just say, oh, let me go to the beach. Let me enjoy this weather. No, I said, thank you for the weather, but I've got to work. Because the heat is going to be on even California. We thought, oh, the ocean will cool us down. Well, not entirely, right? Ah, we're too mellow, laid back. Everybody loves everybody out here. So I can't have any problems. No hate out here. No troubles. So the frogs jumping around a lot here. It was really jumpy. Passing in the slow lane, passing in the exit ramps. It's hard. I realized today, why is it so difficult to drive here? There's a lot of reasons, but one of the most compelling reasons is everyone's going so fast in the slow lane now that when we're merging, going up a hill onto the freeway from a city street or something, emerging on the freeway, we can't get up to 80 miles an hour just like that. And the cars are zipping by at 80 miles an hour in the slow lane. It is very difficult to merge. I mean, I almost got run over by a BMW today. I just said, wow, come on. I really have to just punch it. I really have to just step on the accelerator too. In order to do proper merging now, you have to get up to speed and come on the freeway fast. You got to really, like, up to speed very fast. They'll run you over. You'll cause a problem. So this is the trouble here. If you got a slow car, you're in trouble trying to drive here. People are going too fast in the slow lane, and trucks are going in the middle lane now. They're not supposed to. 3-lane highway, the trucks are supposed to be in the slow lane, but they're going in the middle lane now. They're going fast. I don't know what's going on. The way we drive is changing. And most of the car, I mean, there's so many BMWs here, it's unbelievable. I just started to see, it's like, does everybody have a BMW or an Audi? It seems like it. And of course, these cars can go fast. There's either Infiniti or Audi or BMW here. It seems like Mercedes. Yeah, it's just Audi. Yeah, I probably said that. Everybody's got a new fast car. And so they're just driving lickety-split, weaving around. See a truck in the middle. See, the problem is the truck's going in the middle lane, so everybody's in the fast lane is real fast, and people say, hey, I want to get around this truck. They go in the slow lane and speed past the truck. See, it's causing a big problem. Got to get around the truck. A lot of people don't want to go in the fast lane which is going real too fast. So they'll go in the fast, the slow lane, they do 70 in the slow lane. Whereas you're used to having cars do 50, 55, 60 in the slow lane, really. Trucks supposed to do 55. They're doing 65, 70 now, actually, the trucks. This is dangerous. Don't want the trucks going like that fast. They can only slow down so fast and maneuver so well. Not designed for that, really. Yeah, you need a car that can go from 30 miles an hour to 75 in a matter of, 3 seconds or something. Really, it's fast. No more of the slow merging on going up 45. Now I'm going 50. Everybody's slamming their brakes behind you. People by hand are slamming, are cutting into the middle lane. Oh, I got to get around these people. They just braked, and it creates this trouble, this ripple effect on the freeway. It really does. Got to be really conscious of just rapid acceleration onto the freeway. And older people, of course, they're not used to that. We're not used to that. We're trained not to do that. Merge kind of slowly. Let the traffic go by. But there's no slow traffic to go by. It's all fast. And so there's no opportunity to merge. It's causing troubles. It's hard. It's very difficult on older people here to drive. Exceedingly difficult. This is why one other reason I had to get in better shape. I got to feel very nimble and quick and feel like I can keep up with this, the young, because there's so many young people here in the Silicon Valley. All the jobs are for the young people. So there's all these 20-something people driving BMWs. That's true. Most of the jobs here, massive job market, are all to the young people. They don't hire older people. So it's go, 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 go. Quick reflexes, zooming around you. If you're an old person, it's like, what in the world's going on here? It's just scary. So I need to feel younger here just to survive. Absolutely. What did I have today? Breakfast. And we're just like letting this wow dissipate, of course, in a wise way here. Casual way. Started out and I made a smoothie. Odwalla blueberry protein drink and frozen fruit, frozen berry, mixture of frozen berries. Made a smoothie with that. That's what I had all day long. That's it. Until dinner, had salad spinach with a little bit of cheese, a few little nuts. Some onions, I cut up onions, and then cottage cheese. I put cottage cheese on it for protein. That's it. Cottage cheese, some spinach. That's the whole day. That's what I had to eat. Maybe I'll have some Greek yogurt before I go to bed. Get a little more protein. Nightcap. Greek yogurt nightcap. So this is the discipline. Yeah, this is discipline I got to. Look forward to it the next day. Look forward to it. I get different flavors of the protein drink. So every day it's a different thing. I'll do a little something different tomorrow. Maybe the chocolate or something. I don't know what to mix with that, though. That's a good question. What do you mix with chocolate? Well, banana. Oh, I had a banana. I put a banana in the smoothie. It made it taste different, but good. It made it thicker. All right, it's different. So chocolate and banana and blueberries, something like that. I'll with the chocolate, banana, and blueberry protein drink. Sounds great. I'll just keep doing that until I get sick of it. If I can't do it anymore. It goes in phases. You do get tired of it eventually, but if you're smart and you have different flavors, and you can keep yourself going. Maybe I'll throw some Greek yogurt in with the shake. Chocolate, protein drink, blueberries, banana, and Greek yogurt. That sounds great. That'll keep me going the whole day. And the protein, the chocolate shake's like 32 grams. The Greek yogurt will be another 20 or so. That's 52 grams of protein. That's enough. And banana and blueberries give me good stuff. And yeah, I'll try that. So the good habits is a gradual thing. It builds up momentum. You just have to start somewhere and be artful about it, be creative about it, and just say, you know, I'm not just gonna think I'm just gonna try this a little bit, and just ease your way into it. Ease your way into it. I've been doing this now. The smoothies, I just kind of gotten this like little, let's just try it as a fling type of thing. I always had to buy this NutriBullet, and then gradually I tried a few things, and I stopped. I then went back to it and tried. It's just sort of been a gradually refine it, refine it. It takes a while. You'll stop and quit for a while, and then go back to it. Kind of overdid it at first. Tried to say, well, I'm gonna be super healthy immediately. Throw in the goji berries, and the acai, and the what are those seeds? I can't remember the name of them. Chia seeds, throw in the chia seeds. And the other stuff. Flax seeds, chia seeds. This is like, oh, doesn't taste so good. So I tried to get like instant health. It didn't work. And so you realize that you have to refine it and, you know, become better and better at it. So that's what I've done. Now I have some ways to make it taste really good and still it's healthy and still it works. You know, I don't have to overdo it. Maybe I'll throw some goji berries in that chocolate shake. Why not? The chocolate protein shake, goji berries. They're good. Nothing wrong with goji berries. Maybe I'll put some dried cherries in too. Why not? Go for it tomorrow. I want to do that. You gotta compensate for the how good chocolate tastes for throwing a bunch of healthy stuff in too. But I'm not gonna throw any kale in there. No, I'm not gonna go that far. I want to ruin the chocolate taste. And I'm gonna throw the kale in there. I'll do that maybe later at night. Gotta do the kale spinach thing too. Come on, I gotta do it tomorrow. That's something I gotta do. Maybe banana. Throw banana, cranberry juice, banana, and some and kale. Why not? So we're just, you know, coming down off the high of this breakthrough, whatever it was. We know what it was, but we're not trying to reference it so much. It's just, we're just coming back down to earth, as it were, here. Just come back down to earth like this and just kind of chit chat. Foods, diet, sports, weather, right? Great. Just stay away from personalities and politics and religion and all this stuff. You just stay away from the fear stuff. Just talk about good habits. So talk about your good habits. What are the good habits that I'm engaged in? This is a great way to come down from this intense breakthroughs. So what are the good habits? How am I going to continue those good habits? Jump rope. I can do 50 at a stretch now without tripping on it. It's like, wow, I could do 50. That's a pretty good exercise, right? A jump rope. We hate doing it because it's difficult, but really, it's quite good. Requires balance and timing. Gets cardio going. Then try balance. Bend over backwards as much as possible. See if you keep your balance and bend this way or bend that way. Get on one leg. Just keep do balancing exercises. And remember to breathe in and out when you're doing exercises. I tend to hold my breath when I'm doing anything difficult, but no, it's just keep the breath going even when you're doing vigorous exercise. Try to keep your breath steady, and you'll find it's easier, a lot easier. You don't lose your balance. You keep your balance better. We hold our breath, we tend to lose our balance. It tends after a while. Yeah, I'm getting hungry. I'm gonna have something. What time is it? It's 11 o'clock. I'm gonna have that Greek yogurt tonight. I'm telling you. A little bit. Yeah. It just get hungry. The hungries are hitting. When the hungries hit the Red Barn. There used to be this burger chain called the Red Barn. I don't think you see it around anymore. But I always thought that was pretty cool. I don't think I ever went to one. Look for the big Red Barn for your burgers. I miss the burger culture. That was pretty fun. You knew it was bad for you, but you're young. You say, who cares? There's the ketchup and the mustard is, wow, this can't be good for me. Cheese and the fries and the shake. Love the shakes. Oh my gosh. Vanilla, good vanilla shake, strawberry shake, chocolate shake, a good rich dark chocolate shake. I just want to be young forever so I can just keep scarfing down these shakes. Is it? But some of these chocolate protein shakes, they taste great. I mean, they just taste, wow, really good. Too good, it seems like. I'm a little afraid of them. So the wow is still reverberating. Absolutely it is. Absolutely. So we think there's some... What else is to it? Where's the magic? No, this is it. This is it. This is it. We just got to the stupendous breakthrough. You know, why should we second guess ourselves? This is what works. This works. This path works. You get all these truck drivers tricking out their trucks and they don't haul any freight. And you get the one that hauls the freight. Why? Because they know their truck can haul the freight. The ones that are tricking out their trucks, they say, I know my truck can't handle this haul. You know, cannot handle this run. So I'll spend my time tricking out the truck, making it look like it's better than it is. You get the little truck that doesn't have the engine and transmission to handle it. They put all these lights here and, you know, painting and all this. There's all sorts of ways to make a truck look, wow, look at the chrome, put all the chrome on it. But they never haul the freight. That's a truck driving analogy. Days on the road. Was that Dudley? 8 days on the road. The truck, truck driving songs are kind of cool. Truck driving culture in America. It's without that, there wouldn't be any America actually. Without the truck drivers. Used to be trains, but truck drivers. They're like UPS, awesome company. Wow, I was just like in awe of UPS. They just. How they do what they do is just really extraordinary. I mean, that company is brisk. It's amazing. Get these drivers, they're such good drivers, but they drive fast, they're brisk. They run in, package, go back, boom, off the next place. The whole company is just like this can-do briskness to it. Hard as something in Florida. 2 days later, it's in San Jose. It's like, wow. They say it'll be delivered tomorrow. I guarantee it'll be delivered tomorrow. I have no doubt about it. Sometimes 6 o'clock, 6:30, UPS driver comes in. Here you go. They're always friends, so friendly. And great, great people they hire. I don't know. This is an amazing company. They're always wearing shorts, right? Even in winter. I think they wear shorts even in winter. They got this uniform, UPS uniform. I know, what happens to old UPS vans? I never see them. What has some graveyard there? There must be some massive amount, right? I never see them changed and tricked out on the streets, people just driving old UPS vans, you know, like repainting them or whatever. You know, they never see that. What do? They part them out, they melt them down. So we want to know, UPS, what do you do with your old trucks, old vans, actually, truck van? My dad used to drive an old bakery van. My uncle used to live in an old truck van, bakery van. Really nice, really, really. He spent 20 years living in that or more. A lot of people used to live in these old delivery vans. They were very well built, like trailers. I mean, you could fit them with beds and everything. They're like the precursor to RVs. These delivery trucks, the bakeries used to have them, milk trucks, whatever. Yeah. They're very, very popular among young people. My dad drove one all the way down to Guatemala and all through Central America. I think it was a bakery delivery van. He fixed it all up with shelving and sleep quarters and everything. Four on the floor, I'm sure. Maybe five on the floor, stick shift. So those things went and went and went and went. Those are great, great vehicles. I just talked to somebody today, that 58 Chevy Biscayne. He says, best car he's ever had. The thing says it's unbelievable. Went forever. Went forever. Totally reliable. Never had to do anything to it. It just went forever. Lasted so long with so much use. And it just seats six adults easily. Six adults easily in there. Those cars built like a tank. It's true. It's true. That was before planned obsolescence. They built these things to last forever. Love it. Love the quality. I love the quality in the older stuff. You don't see it anymore. Went to buy a vacuum cleaner today. I said, this thing... Sneeze tried to hit me. Came on strong. I said, this vacuum, this thing is going to break the moment I touch it. It's crazy. All the stress points are made of this cheap plastic. What are they talking about? 6 months top is insane. I can't buy it. Nothing. They're all built the same way. It's just hideous. And then someone told me that Sears used to make these vacuum cleaners, industrial vacuum cleaners. They last forever. You could stand on top of them like ladders. I mean, they're just built so sturdy. Hotels use them. You know, the equipment the hotels have is more industrial. You can still get industrial stuff, good stuff for hotels and things, but for consumers, we're the frog in the pot. You just look at the stuff, you say, this is not going to last. I know it isn't. And then you think, well, I'm going to spend $100 here. 6 months, it's going to be broken. You know, I'm going to be broke. And what kind of life is this? It's a hideous life compared to what it used to be. My grandmother, she bought stuff she bought one time. She said, I never want to buy anything again. This is just one. And so everything she bought lasted her entire life once she ended up buying it. And then she had all this money for retirement and traveled the world for many, many years. But us, we can't even retire because we're having this junk keeps breaking on us. Oh, what kind of world is this? It's hideous. It's just absolutely hideous. So we need this sense of ease. We need the sense of ease to completely trump the world. And it does. Trump the world. We look at it, well, it's a cool design, but it's broken. I need to vacuum stuff up. It won't work. The lid won't stay on. It's broken. This piece of plastic. I can't order this piece of plastic. It's integrated in the stupid thing. I have to buy a whole new one. You try to get a tool fixed. It costs more than buying a new one. This is true.
It costs more than buying a new one just to get something fixed on a tool. If we want $400 to fix it, it takes 2 months. I says, forget it. I just buy a new one. All that stuff is just junk. I mean, this is ridiculous. Before they made stuff to be fixed. Vacuum tubes. You know, replace the vacuum tube. The radio lasts forever. Disposable society. Even people are disposable now. Yeah, I don't feel disposable, but I think young people, their attitudes are, we're disposable, everyone's disposable. No, I'm not disposable. Period. That's the attitude I have. I am not disposable. Not something to be tossed in the, you know, in the garbage. The focus on spiritual virtuosity is not garbage. It's not to be disposed of. So, we need to feel that we're valuable in this way. Value yourself. Not your evaluating of illusion, but value your willingness to accept the fact that you're perfect. You're perfect spiritual virtuoso, along with everyone else. That's valuable. That's not disposable. That's not something to be thrown away that lasts forever. Let the Holy Spirit do whatever evaluating needs to be done. Let the Holy Spirit do it however it wants to. Free us from time and collapse time completely, ultimately. Let the Holy Spirit do that. We just do our part here. How are we doing on this taping right now? How are we doing? Pretty good, aren't we? Yeah, it's probably going to come to an end. It's coming up here, so. Doing really well. Weather's not too cold. I like this weather. Not too cold. Because the storms come in, it always brings warm air with it at first. I like the approach of storms. I just don't like the aftermath. Where everything is now soaked and wet, and then the cold, clear air comes in, and it's wet and damp and cold and miserable. Hey, but we got the baseball meetings going on, so that warm heats things up. Hot stove league. Instant multimillionaires being made. They say, $120 million contract. Nah, forget it. Are you kidding me? I'm insulted by that. Well, at least 160. Million dollars. Come on. I'm 32. I got a couple years left, and you have to eat the buck back end of the contract, but what's $80 million among friends? Come on. It's a different world. Just let the wow cool down. We just revisit it a little bit just to see how it feels. Yeah, it's still very intense. Feel very intense. That happens after a while. You let it cool down. You might just sort of obliquely reference it a little bit. And then you say, oh, wow. The heat's still on. It's still there. Yeah. Great. Very great. Do this taping. Get this out to the world, broadcast to the world. It's already broadcast in real time, mentally, everywhere.
Greek yogurt coming up. That's how I look at it. Have a happy nightcap. Letting this wind down here. So, just about over with. Okay, great. Very great job, those who've viewed this and gone through this experience. Tremendous job. You get the real time, real experience of how it really happens. Now we know how it really happens. How the spiritual path really happens. It does happen. This is how it happens. Our patience, our perseverance, our determination, our faith in the grace of God. All those combine. The sum is greater than the parts. Breakthroughs happen because of it. Yeah, we're really close now.
It's almost like this is it.
Second, this is it. Boom.
Ours gonna go a little longer.
That's good.
Any second now.
Okay. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow.